everyone. Thank you, everyone that's joining from the membership across local government in Queensland, and for our wonderful presenters that have been really patient with us as we've been trying to navigate technology, timings, dates, etc. So we finally landed on something today. So welcome. I'll just share my screen and do a couple of quick introductions, and then we can get underway and hand over to some of the speakers that we have before us. So let me make sure that everyone can see that. So excellent. So this is the first of a series that we've been working on. Paul Cranch and myself have been working on at LGAQ to try to bring together local leaders across the state of Queensland at a local level, so from local government, with some of the state government, federal government, and industry and academia, to try to advance some of these strategic priority areas that can help, I guess, advance the economic impact across the state. And one of those areas is, and so one of the first areas is the bioeconomy. So before I jump into that in too much detail, I might just go through a little bit of housekeeping, and we can then talk a bit about the agenda for today. So firstly, this presentation is going to be recorded because of the fact that it's, I think, the end of financial year and lots of things happening. We have had a lot of interest for this session, yet a lot of people have expressed disappointment that they aren't able to attend, but are really quite eager to listen to the presentation and the recording afterwards, and hopefully connect with some of the speakers afterwards as well. So this will be recorded. I'd like to just ask people if they can mute their microphone and just turn it back on when they're speaking, to avoid the stray dog and kids in the background. We have allowed, so we've got some time for Q&A after each speaker. So the intent of this is just to make it a bit more intimate, as opposed to waiting to the end of the session to open it up for Q&A. So if you've got questions, you can, down the bottom here, you can actually just raise your hands, and then Paul or myself will just call on you. If you're really shy or tied up for some reason, you can just put a question in the chat, but we'd actually rather if you could just raise your hands, that way we can see and hear from you as well. And I think with that, we might just kind of move into it. So quick introductions. My name's David Camerlengo. I've been working with LGAQ more in an advisory role to help support LGAQ and its members and councils to, progress some of their trade and investment agendas. I essentially support the great work that Paul Cranch does, who's the lead for trade and investment there at LGAQ, has got a whole bunch of different initiatives and programs to support councils across Queensland, which many of you guys would probably know Paul. Paul, you should say hi at some point. Probably now would be a good time, actually.
Hey, everyone. Welcome.
Excellent. And we're really excited to have some of the great representative from councils here today. So as I touched on, these sessions are really, I think what we, particularly in the last couple of years that I've been involved with LGAQ, we experienced or we saw some of the difficulties in aligning local government intelligence, agenda, opportunities, insights with and bringing that forward with state government agendas and federal government agendas, and that flow of information between the three levels of government, and also overlaying that with the industry, industry drivers and industry perspectives that might help, if with that knowledge, might actually help councils to be able to position themselves to help support, to help move forward some of these, hopefully, investment opportunities that can drive some great outcomes for their regions. So today's, we actually split this session up, the bioeconomy forum session, into two sessions. So last week, we actually had the first of our session, which was more focused on government. So we had representatives from the state government, Department of State Development, representatives from Trade and Investment Queensland. We had some international representatives from CAFE overseas, Chris Tindall. We had representatives from TIQ in Japan, bringing some international perspectives, but trying to bring the understanding of where the government's headed. And we also had representatives from the federal government through ARENA and what they're doing with the bioenergy roadmap. Today's session is much more industry focused. So you're actually going to hear from predominantly representatives from industry talking through some of the case studies of their businesses and some of the projects that they've got off the ground. So firstly, I do have to thank our sponsors. Shahana and the team at Bioenergy Australia have been really instrumental in helping us put together a great program. So thank you, Shahana, and to Lisa, everyone there at Bioenergy Australia. I'd like to thank the folks from Queensland Government, Trade and Investment Queensland, and Life Sciences Queensland as well to help to coordinate these sessions. Hopefully at some point we can get back to maybe having these in person. So with that, this is what the agenda will look like for today. So we'll hand over to, I might hand over to Shahana immediately after this to maybe just provide a bit of an overview of the domestic landscape in bioenergy. We're very grateful to have Chris Wilcox, who's dialing in from Denver with Gevo, to talk through where Gevo's headed from an aviation fuels perspective. There's Chris can talk a little bit about the pilot project that they have delivered here in Queensland with Brisbane Airport and Virgin and so forth. We'll then hear from Jeff Bell from Microbiogen to talk a little bit about bio-based chemicals. We've got Greg Appleby from Sydney Water is going to talk through a case study of a biogas facility at one of their wastewater or at their wastewater treatment plants. And then we've basically circled the world and landed right back into Queensland. I'm going to hear from Stuart Peters talking through a bit of a case study in northern Queensland around taking, I guess, waste streams through to bioproducts as well in Queensland. So with that, I'm going to shut up and stop talking, and I'm going to hand over to Shahana. Shahana, you can provide a bit of a perspective on what you're seeing from Bioenergy Australia.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. And look, thanks so much for coordinating this and inviting us to participate. I am now going to find the screen that I need to share. Okay, can everyone see that?
Yes, yes.
Great. Okay, perfect. Well, look, thank you very much. I suppose just, and I'm going to skim over this really quickly because I'm assuming that most people on the call have already have a bit of an idea in terms of bioenergy. But effectively, bioenergy is taking a range of different organic waste materials or residues, utilising a range of different conversion technologies to produce a range of different products that can go into market. That's continually expanding in terms of, and Jeff's obviously going to talk about some of the bits in the high-end kind of value chemicals and the like, but, you know, there's significant R&D investment that's taking place across this sector at the moment at a global level. So the list is expanding and the applications are growing very quickly. In terms of, I suppose, just to give an indication to those councils that are attending, you know, the range of available feedstocks that can go into bioenergy is incredibly broad. And it doesn't necessarily need to be one particular feedstock as a single. It can be co-mingling of feedstocks and the like. So just to give a little indication there in terms of the different opportunities around the feedstocks. Now getting to, I suppose, the domestic drivers that have significantly increased the size of my inbox and phone calls in the last 4 months. We successfully advocated in the lead up to the last federal election for the development of a bioenergy roadmap for Australia and for that to be a Commonwealth funded activity. That was announced late last year, and there was the public call for submissions in February, maybe March, I can't remember, of this year. They received over 140 submissions into that process, which was really quite remarkable. I'm getting a little bit of background noise from people, so I might just check that everyone has their things on mute. That'd be great. And so what we have seen is a significant increase in the level of interest around what bioenergy could mean for local councils, for state governments, for large industry, for a range of different applications and needs. In addition to that, there's obviously been in the last month a lot of activity around the technology investment roadmap. And we've been really pleased with the significant inclusion of bioenergy and biofuels through that technology investment roadmap. We've obviously submitted into that process, and we've had assurances that the bioenergy roadmap will play a direct role into that. And so for us, we really do see that there's going to be some policy interventions in the near future that will be supporting the development of the industry. In terms of, I suppose, other drivers that are driving the level of increase around bioenergy, one particular area is around biomethane. So injection of upgraded biogas into the gas network across Australia, and for that to be able to be used as a significant opportunity for decarbonisation of the gas network. So there's been a number of reports that have been issued in the last sort of 12 to 15 months that we have issued, or other groups such as Energy Networks Australia. And just a couple of weeks ago, we actually released a joint letter from 24 organisations, which you can see all the logos over there, including the Business Council of Australia and the like, calling for the development of a biomethane industry in Australia. As you can see, forgive those dot points, that's a bit of a error there. France currently has, actually it's probably more now, 59 sites injecting and 297 on the wait list for connection. We currently have none in Australia in terms of projects directly connecting biomethane into the system. Another example is Copenhagen have made a commitment to be 100% biogas in their gas network by 2025. And the beauty of biomethane is, you know, you are effectively capturing methane that would otherwise be going into the atmosphere. So piggeries, abattoirs, feedlots, wastewater treatment, dairy processing, ag processing, any of those sort of industries that are creating a lot of wastewater, there is an opportunity there to really assess the options for that to be utilised into the network. In addition to that, we do, in terms of our membership base, one of the significant growth areas in our membership base has been the gas pipeline owners and those that are interested in driving a market for renewable gas. The reason for that is that biomethane effectively operates the same as natural gas. It won't have any corrosive effect on the gas pipeline, and it doesn't require any appliance upgrading, which is one of the challenges in terms of hydrogen. The blend rate has to stay at a certain percent before there needs to be significant upgrading of appliances. An interesting statistic on this one, I don't have one on Queensland, but in New South Wales, if we were actually to capture all of the methane currently being emitted from wastewater treatment plants, piggeries, abattoirs and the like, other areas that I mentioned, it would actually supply enough biomethane to cover the entire domestic gas usage in New South Wales. So we're not talking about tiny little bits of gas here, we're talking about a significant opportunity. Another driver that is very hot right now is around fuel security and transport emissions. We've actually seen there's been over the last, over the COVID period, we've gone from four functioning fossil oil refineries down to two now operating. And that's taken us from a 60% refinery capacity here in Australia down to around a 35 to 40% in terms of what that contribution is to our fuel security. In addition to that, you know, it is commonly known that 90% of our petroleum products that we're utilising, driving around, et cetera, they are coming from imported base. So whether it's imported crude or whether it is imported refined product. So we do see that is a significant area that is currently having a bit of a reassessment. I think if the two refineries do remain closed and there is that significant reduction in domestic capacity in terms of oil, then we will be, you know, Australia will need to look at other solutions fast track rather than, I suppose, an assumption that it's going to be okay. There was a study by Queensland University of Technology that showed if we were to implement a simple mechanism such as a 10% national E10 mandate, in terms of the investment that would drive, that would actually create over 8,000 jobs in regional Australia, and it would provide a plus 18% to our fuel security base. So that is an area that is getting a lot of attention at the moment from a federal government level. And we're certainly working with them around the opportunity for biofuels to become the predominant refining industry in this country. Another domestic driver is obviously around the China sword and around an increased level of relevance and spotlight, I suppose, on waste in Australia, whether that's been through ABC television programs, whether it's been through the development of a national waste strategy. But there certainly has been a spotlight that has gone onto that space, which has not really been there previously. And I suppose in terms of the specific areas that bioenergy can play a significant role is around those organic waste streams. So diverting organic waste streams from landfill sites, being able to utilise those to capture the methane or provide other products. In addition to that, there is, you know, we're seeking to and we're seeing quite an interesting level of interest from local councils that are exploring options that they can be really driving that agenda themselves in terms of reducing landfill reliance and seeking to provide a level of, you know, job creation and self-sustainability within their own regions. COVID, it was interesting actually because my original presentation on this topic was around the global drivers and it feels like the timing is quite not, you know, not quite right to be talking about those global drivers as the main sort of front runner. The interesting thing that's actually happened in COVID is that there's been, I think, a doubling down on domestic, you know, capacity and self-sufficiency and strategic industries and a realisation that when China closes its doors for 40 days and all of the factories shut down, that we are exposed. And certainly that was really highlighted over the period of COVID with hand sanitizer and disinfectant supply, as well as other PPE. But I suppose in terms of from our perspective, you know, we saw the entire ethanol industry having to shift from supplying fuel-grade ethanol whilst they were still supplying fuel-grade ethanol, but they really had to pivot their businesses to supply pharmaceutical-grade or industrial-grade ethanol to be able to make sure that we had available hand sanitizer in this country. Now, the interesting component to that conversation, which didn't quite make the headlines, was the only reason that we have an ethanol industry in this country is because of the fuel mandates in New South Wales and Queensland. So whether you're a supporter or not of those mandates, what those mandates have provided is a level of stable supply of ethanol in Australia. And in the event that we didn't have those mandates, the likelihood of actually having ethanol facilities in this country is very low, and therefore we would have been incredibly exposed. There was effectively no hand sanitizer or ethanol coming from China for 40 days over the period that we were at the peak. And so that's been something that has really sparked the interest of, you know, the industry minister at the federal level. And there is now some really strategic thinking around how do we now ensure that into the future we have stable industries across all of these sorts of sectors to ensure that we're not going to be left exposed. Something that I suppose COVID, but before COVID as well, is the lack of a federal regional transition strategy for regional economies in Australia. What is the plan? What is the grand plan to ensure that there are jobs in regions, that there is the ability for people to be able to choose to stay in regions? And from our perspective, bioenergy across all of its facets is basically exclusively regional. These are jobs in the regions. These are jobs where the feedstock is closest to. These are jobs that can be, that will be employing highly skilled, high paid workforces, but all the way through in terms of the workforce mix. It is what we believe should be really at the cornerstone of a regional transition strategy in Australia. Now to talk about, I suppose, the global drivers just really quickly, and it's great that Chris is going to be speaking. You know, there are two significant industries that use a huge amount of fuel. that have made some very large commitments at a global level. So both of those two industries, so aviation and also the marine sector, have set a 50% reduction in emissions by 2050. And for both of those industries, really the significant pathway for them to achieve that is through transitioning to renewable fuels. That will really, in terms of aviation, and Chris will speak to this more, there aren't a lot of other options. In fact, probably I would say, given COVID and what's taking place in the aviation industry, I would say that there probably aren't really any other options other than utilising existing technology and infrastructure in order to be able to decarbonise. And so similarly, in terms of the shipping sector, you know, these assets in terms of these significant ships are on the water or in the air for, you know, a lot longer than a car is driven around in Australia. And so that needs to be taken into account in terms of any sort of transition strategy for those sectors. And fuel is effectively the key opportunity across both of them. So we're seeing a range of things in terms of the development of jet fuels, biojet fuels. There's a lot of interest in terms of developing projects here in Australia. We run something called the Sustainable Aviation Fuels Alliance of Australia and New Zealand that contains all the airlines and airports. And we're really working across the sector to see what are the drivers that are required in order to create that investment opportunity for developing projects in Australia. Bioenergy globally. So bioenergy is seen through the IEA's lens as really the overlooked giant of renewables. They predicted that bioenergy was going to be the largest growth area in renewables from 2018 to 2023. And as you can see, where Australia sits on that level at the moment, we sit 6 from the bottom in terms of our current bioenergy source. Now, I suppose in looking at that, we could look at that and say, wasn't that terrible? Or we can look at that and say that's a massive opportunity in terms of potential, in terms of job creation, in terms of investment in regional Australia, that the fact that we are really not doing so many things that so many other countries are doing, such as gas capture, such as biofuels, it really does provide a significant opportunity for us to invest in an entirely new industry. We released something called the KPMG State of the Nation report in 2018, and that sought to identify and rank in terms of the opportunities for bioenergy in a state level. And that really did show that Queensland came out really head and shoulders above others in terms of their approach around seeing the bio future as a, you know, as a whole of government approach, as an opportunity to be able to drive regional jobs and investment across the sector. And that just gives you a little bit of a snapshot in terms of what makes up bioenergy across each of the states. So you can see there in terms of how Queensland is placed against others. And that's me. I think I probably went over time, so apologies.
That was brilliant, Shahana. Thanks so much for that. That was really helpful, I think, to provide a bit of context and perspective, particularly in the current environment as well. I might just throw to see if anyone has any questions. I think that probably inspired a whole bunch of questions, but we might just throw out there to see if anyone has any specific questions. Otherwise, we might just continue on. Yeah, perfect. I guess, Shahana, just quickly, is there, and I think we've got a few good case studies today, I think what we're always trying to figure out with these sessions is what is the role of local government and where can local government help support and help advance? And I guess you can answer that in two ways. One is directly giving some thoughts about what role local government can play, or even pointing to maybe some case studies or some good examples of local governments that are a bit more advanced in this space.
Yeah, well, I think there's two things. I think that one key opportunity is that local government is really at the core of the community. And so the ability for local government to play a role in bringing together industry to be able to look at opportunities where they could invest in a project together. So, you know, I mean, we're looking at, you know, there's areas such as the Griffith region in New South Wales, Gladstone, obviously, in Queensland, where they've set an agenda which has identified that bioenergy could play a significant role. And so they're now seeking to develop their own, effectively, their own bioenergy strategy on, okay, what could it look like based on our feedstocks? What would be the key opportunities for us in terms of outputs? You know, are we close to a port? Are we close to an airport? Where can we link in and what role can we play? So that would be the first thing. I would say that local councils are actually an enabler for people to come together and industries to be connected in order to identify what that path is going to be. The second thing I would say is that local councils, you know, they're the beholders of waste. In terms of whether it is wastewater treatment plants, whether it is landfill sites, you know, they're actually utilising or have the ability to be able to set their own agendas in that space. So to be able to say, you know, by 2030, we want to have zero organics to landfill, or, you know, I mean, just a simple kind of statement such as that, then lends everyone to say, well, what are we going to do with all of those organics then? So it provides then a pathway to be considering other options.
Yeah,
I would say that they're probably the two sort of key opportunities in terms of local council and the role that it can play.
Yeah, perfect. Excellent. Thanks, Johanna. And I noticed Stuart had just posted a question in the chat before we move on, is around the, and maybe, I'm not sure if you can answer this, it might be a question for Arena, but the bioenergy roadmap, he's put here, when do you think the bioenergy roadmap will actually translate to government policies or mandates?
So, I mean, the minister did request, on our request, that the bioenergy roadmap was going to provide policy advice in terms of when the analysis is done of what are the areas of bioenergy that have the highest level of competitive advantage in Australia that we really should be driving as the key opportunities, that included within that will be, and here are the policy solutions that could support that agenda. We have been given assurances that that piece of work will feed directly into the technology investment roadmap. Mm. And that technology investment roadmap is essentially going to be highlighting what are those key areas that we should be driving investment, you know, through public support, but also through private investment. And so my expectation on all of that is that it will be around October of this year that the information will be shared on both of those fronts, really, in terms of the bioenergy roadmap and one of the specific sort of areas and opportunities, as well as that technology investment roadmap, which is due to come out a little bit earlier than that, but our bioenergy roadmap is going into that earlier. So that's the expectation from our front.
Excellent. Thanks so much, Shahan. I think you've given us lots to think about for sure. So really appreciate it. Cool. We may now fly across the Pacific. Sorry, I'm actually just trying to share very quickly my screen at the same time. Struggled to talk and navigate at the same time to Denver to hear from Chris. Chris, are you still there? Hopefully.
I'm still here, yeah.
All
yeah.
right, perfect. Yeah, so Chris is no stranger to Queensland. He's been here a number of times. Actually, I think just more recently you were at the Gladstone Bioenergy Forum that Shahan and the team had put on in Gladstone.
I barely got out in time. Yeah,
yeah, you did. Yeah, we almost kept you here. So
yeah,
cool. We might throw to you then, Chris. Run with it. I'll stop sharing.
Great. Well, thank you. Here, let me share my screen, and I'll do something similar here with the presentation. Is that working? Did that come up?
Not as yet, no. Share, hit and share. Got the share button.
Yeah, I shared it. And is that coming up?
No. Do you want me to pull it up? I've got a presentation you sent a couple of weeks ago, but
Sure. Yeah. Let me see here.
Have you got, sometimes the whole multiple monitors always messes with Pete. There we go.
Is that it?
There you go. Perfect.
Okay. I apologize, everyone, for the difficulty there, but anyway, here. Yeah, so I appreciate, thanks for giving me a couple minutes here to talk with everyone.
Hey, Chris, I was just going to say, do you want to try and go to presentation mode? That way we can maybe see a little bit bigger in the bottom right there.
Let's see.
Do you have that? Yeah, there you go. Much better. Perfect.
There it is. Okay.
Cool.
Yeah, so I thought I'd give everyone a little background about who we are, what we do, and kind of how we look at things, and then what we've been doing in Australia, and particularly in Queensland and at the Brisbane Airport there. So Jivo, we're a renewable fuels producer. We've got a technology. It's carbohydrate-based technology, meaning that our feedstock is carbohydrates, sugars essentially, and we don't really care where the sugars come from, whether they're first gen sort of feedstocks or they're, you know, next gen, second generation feedstocks, cellulosic feedstocks, wood and that sort of thing. We just want to make sure that our feedstocks are carbon efficient. That's the most important thing for us, is that we're solving the problem here. And the fuels that we make, we're making drop-in fuels. So we're making fuels that fit within the existing infrastructure, that work within the existing markets, where we're not trying to alter anything. We're just utilizing things that are out there already and not creating additional investment downstream in order to use the product. So we make isobutanol as kind of the first step. So isobutanol is an alcohol. It would be a replacement for ethanol. If you know, ethanol is a 2-carbon alcohol. Everyone knows it has its problems. Isobutanol is a bit more elegant solution in terms of an oxygenate for fuel. It's a 4-carbon alcohol. It has very high energy density, higher than ethanol, so you don't have the problems of losing out on fuel mileage like you do with ethanol. Isobutanol doesn't take on water, doesn't phase separate, so it's a much more elegant oxygenate than ethanol is. And then from isobutanol, we further convert onto isooctane, which is a gasoline blend component. It's a true hydrocarbon, so it's like alkylate. It's an octane component in the gasoline, and jet fuel, sustainable aviation fuel. So we make isobutanol, isooctane, and jet fuel, and in the future we'll be making renewable diesel as well. Our plant, right now we've got a couple of different production facilities in Minnesota and another one in Texas. In the U.S. here, we're using corn as our feedstock, not the kind of sweet corn or, you know, that you think of, like corn on the cob. I had corn on the cob last night. That's not the corn we're using. We're using industrially grown corn. The corn itself is grown for protein purposes, for animal feed purposes, and it's all sustainably grown, sustainably harvested. It's all third-party certified. Animals need protein, and that's what the corn is grown for. We extract the sugars, the carbohydrates from the corn, the part that the animal has no use for, and return all of the protein back to the animal. So for every gallon of jet fuel that we produce, we also produce 10 pounds of protein. So this is kind of our product slate thus far. We're in the process of expanding our production facility in Luverne and also expanding our footprint here in the U.S. At several other locations, our production footprint. The reason we like carbohydrates is that we're trying to solve this carbon emission problem, and we're trying to be a big component of how to reduce carbon in the atmosphere, CO2 in the atmosphere, and it's a big problem. If we look at just aviation fuel, at just jet fuel, by 2030, we're going to need 3 billion gallons of sustainable aviation fuel coming online every year. So, and that's just to meet the commitments of the aviation industry and the governments worldwide. So, I mean, you think about 3 billion gallons a year coming online to sort of service this. You need lots of feedstock to do that. And carbohydrates are the most abundant feedstocks available on the planet. There are other feedstocks that, that are out there. Used cooking oil is one of them that is used currently, and it's great. I mean, we should be using used cooking oils and that sort of thing to make renewable diesel and jet fuel. It's probably good for a few hundred million gallons, but then after that, how do we scale? You know, so if you're trying to solve the problem for real, if you're trying to solve it long term, you need something that has a lot of feedstock available that can be sustainably grown and is affordable. I mentioned earlier, you know, we use corn. Our corn is third-party certified. All of our feedstocks are third-party certified by RSV and ISCC Plus. They're kind of the foremost certification bodies globally. It's not enough just to have a bio-based feedstock if that bio-based feedstock is not sustainably produced and not low carbon. You're not really getting to the source. All of our in the U.S. So, you know, we have folks that are out there looking at our farmers, looking at the farming practices out there when they're planting the corn, looking at the fertilizer, how they're using it, you know, how what sustainable farming practices are being used, and certifying that, you know, that our feedstocks are all low carbon. And that's something that you have to do. You know, not only we have to do it here, but if we build a plant anywhere else globally, we're going to be doing the exact same thing. We're going to need third-party certification that all of our feedstocks are low carbon. We, so, you know, from a renewable jet fuel, sustainable aviation fuel, we've been doing this for a little while now. We've flown flights all over the world, supplied airports globally, supplied flights everywhere. It's a bit nuanced, but we've gotten pretty good at it at this point. We've been doing it for a number of years. A few years ago, the way that sustainable aviation fuel was flown on commercial flights or any flights for that matter is it's blended off-site. So the fuel is brought in and it's blended with petrojet, and then it's put into a truck. And then that truck is driven over to the airport and it drives down the tarmac and, you know, drives by the terminal. And then you take the hose out of the truck and you fill up the fuel on wing. And there you go. You're loading up. Well, it's great because you're using sustainable aviation fuel. But that's not a commercially viable, you know, that's not a commercially viable option. You're not going to be able to just drive trucks around. You're adding cost to your fuel on top of what other folks are doing, and you're automatically making your fuel uncompetitive. And so we spent several years working with the O'Hare Fuel Committee, Chicago O'Hare. It's one of the largest airports, you know, in the world, working with the O'Hare Fuel Committee. And we figured out how to do this for real. Like, how would you actually do it? And so what we did was we utilized existing infrastructure off airport, at a terminal that's used by Air BP. We blended it's a Kinder Morgan terminal offsite. We blended our fuel with petroleum-based jet fuel in an existing tank, had it certified, went through the whole process, ran it down the pipeline, had it piped in just like any other fuel is, right into the existing airport infrastructure. And then, you know, the flights are flying commingled fuel. It's got sustainable aviation fuel, it's got petroleum-based fuel, but that's how you do it for real. You know, you take this kind of truck driving around thing out of there and you actually put it in a pipeline like everyone else does, and you fly flights. And so right around this time that we were finishing up that project at O'Hare, I was talking with Rob Wood, who used to be with Virgin Australia. He's now with the Sydney Airport. And Rob was telling me, he's like, look, you know, Virgin Australia, we love the idea of sustainable aviation fuel. We like renewable fuel. We like to support projects. He's like, but when I talk to my folks internally, you know, they're looking at me and they're like, okay, let's say we bought some, you know, let's say the Gevo had a project down here and we're buying sustainable aviation fuel. How are we going to even get it on wing? Like, how do we know we're going to do it? What are the roadblocks? Who's going to step in and try to stop it? What are the issues going to be? I mean, can this even be done? And so Rob and I put together a project with the Brisbane Airport and Virgin Australia and the Queensland government and Caltech and Viva. And we did it for real. So we brought in fuel over the course of a couple of years. And we wanted to do two things. We wanted to use existing infrastructure. We didn't want to spend any capital. We wanted to show that this fuel can be used. You don't need, you know, additional infrastructure. You can use all existing infrastructure. So we wanted to use what was existing. And we wanted to do it over the course of an extended period. We didn't want to just do one delivery and then, you know, show that it works. We wanted, because we knew the first time we did it, we're going to have a ton of hurdles. So we wanted to do this multiple times and get this thing flowing and get it working and get all the kinks worked out. And so that's what we did. So, of course, you know, we bring in our first load of sustainable aviation fuel and we're running into all kinds of problems. And just because people have never seen it before. Let me take a step back real quick here. So sustainable aviation fuel, our fuel, it's not like ethanol and gasoline. Our jet fuel is jet fuel. It's a like molecule, totally fungible. We spent about 5 years and probably $50 million getting our fuel certified through ASTM, which is the certification body in North America for aviation fuel, for jet fuel. We had our fuel tested by every major oil company. It was flown on every major aircraft and engine manufacturer's rigs. We flew multiple flights. It is the most highly scrutinized fuel probably in the world. We were the first ones to kind of go through and have a new pathway certified by ASTM. The kicker of the whole thing is that our fuel is actually better. It's got a higher energy density than traditional petroleum based jet fuel. So, I mean, you get more miles per pound of fuel. It's got a lower freeze point. It doesn't have particulates in it, so it actually burns cleaner. It's a really good fuel. But people obviously, and for good reason, when it's a new fuel, everyone wants to take a look at it. And so sure enough, you know, we brought our fuel in. It was test, you know, even though it was already certified, ASTM certified, and we had all the C of A, it was tested again by everyone, and not only by everyone, but then also by additional third parties. So it probably got tested about 10 times. But then we ran into the snag that in North America, we have ASTM is the certification body. In Australia and Europe, it's DEFSTAN. Now they talk to each other and, you know, and DEFSTAN has sustainable aviation fuel certified, but they just didn't have our pathway checked off yet. So we had to work with DEFSTAN to get our pathway checked off. Anyway, long story short, we worked through it all. All the testing came out great and we were able to do it. And by the time the 2 years was over, I mean, it was going quick. You know, we bring it into Caltech, it was running like clockwork. And so we got over those hurdles. The project itself was an overwhelming success. Brisbane, as we were doing this, viewed as a global leader in sustainable aviation fuel. It was really great. This is all I do is sustainable aviation fuel. I used to fly around the world doing this, but now I talk around the world doing this all the time. And Brisbane was always coming up as, you know, this global leader, Queensland, this global leader in sustainable aviation fuel. It's really fantastic. And so now working with the Queensland government, it's kind of what's next. And, you know, look, we would love, Gevo would love to develop a project in Australia. And I used to think, you know, Australia, boy, it's a prime spot, abundance of raw materials, abundance of feedstock. And, you know, they're just, Australia's being ravaged by climate change. I mean, this is a great opportunity to utilize sustainable aviation fuel, the barrier reef, the fires, you know, that sort of thing. We've really got some. But then to Shahana's point, what this recent kind of virus event, the COVID virus has taught us all is how fragile these supply chains are. And how, you know, Shahana mentioned it, I mean, roughly 90% of the fuel going to Australia is imported. And if you look at jet fuel in Australia, the goal is to have 90-day supply of jet fuel. Last year, April 2019, that supply was about 23 days in Australia. I haven't seen what the numbers were in April of 2020 for Australia. But as you start getting down and your supply shrinks, you run out of jet fuel, you run out of fuels, and it becomes a real economic stopper and it causes panic. So, I mean, beyond the sustainable aspects of this fuel and the fact that it's a better fuel and that, you know, you're not putting carbon into the air, this idea of energy security is just something that I think we all need to think a little bit more about, and not just Australia, I mean the US as well. Australian, the fuel that you fly in Australia, it's all priced out of Singapore. The pricing, it's all based out of Singapore. And, you know, you think about, I know in Houston, in April, they were shutting down ports. You know, the port was shut down for a day, the port of Houston was shut down for a day. Thankfully, it was only a day. We were trying to move product around and there was, you know, people were testing positive and they had to shut things down. I mean, that can happen anywhere. And, you know, things start happening out of Singapore and China, it could be a real issue. So anyway, that's a that energy security is a big deal. And then we've, you know, we also, in addition to commercial flights, we also do a lot with general aviation, business aviation, and that's what this is an example of here. I mentioned that we are expanding our production capabilities over the course of the last year. We've signed a number of long-term agreements with consumers looking for sustainable aviation fuel, and so we, you know, obviously we have to scale up our production capabilities to meet this demand. And then globally, we've got a number of projects that are kind of that we're working on, Australia included, and kind of in the middle of that right now, trying to figure out how to get it done in Australia, how to build a plant, how to do it economically, and kind of what, how to get through some of the policy issues and that sort of thing associated with, you know, bringing in sustainable aviation fuel and building a project. And that's basically what I have. I'm happy to answer questions.
That's brilliant. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Chris. We actually already have a question from Derek. Derek, go for it.
Hey, I just had a quick one. I really like your presentation, and it sounds like there's a lot of positives for sustainable aviation fuel in general, and in your product in particular. So the question I have is a simple one. What are the inhibitors? I mean, is it legislative issues? Is it infrastructure bottlenecks? If you have a fuel that's a better product, and you can bring it in at a good price, and there's all these other drivers about, you know, being self-sufficient and the sustainable aspect. So why isn't this ubiquitous? Why aren't you guys overwhelmed with requests to do projects, and why isn't this moving at light speed?
Yeah. No, that's great. So it's price. It's a pricing issue. When you think about airlines in particular, very cost sensitive. You know, they're very cost sensitive. Pennies matter to them. If you take a step back and you think about this, you think about, all right, so, you know, look, we all pollute, you know, to some degree. And many of the things that we do, we pay for, right? I mean, I just bought a new leaf blower and I had to get rid of my old leaf blower. It wasn't working anymore. I couldn't just throw it away. I had to take it down to the store. I had to pay them because they take it and they recycle it and they take the stuff so that I'm not just throwing it into the landfill and polluting the landfill. I had to pay for it. You know, I fly around in a plane and I'm polluting. I mean, a flight from LA to Sydney, it's like, you know, me driving for a year, you know, like one flight. It's the same sort of carbon output. But I don't pay for it. I don't pay for any of it. You know, there's no cost associated with that. And so in the US, what we've got, a couple of kind of programs in place. So we've got a renewable fuel standard that, you know, requires that we have so much ethanol blended into our feedstock or into our fuel supply, into our petroleum fuel supply. And then that extends into advanced fuels as well, like isobutanol, isooctane, and jet fuel. But then also in states like California and Oregon, they have low carbon fuel standards in place. And so the obligated parties, the companies that are actually causing the pollution, have to buy credits. And what that ends up doing is it makes fuel like our, it helps offset the premium of our fuel and bring it down to parity. And it allows us to sell fuel to folks like Delta. And so there are sort of things in place in the US that help compensate for what we're doing to pay for that fuel. Now, as you gotta remember too, the scale of what we're doing is very small. I mean, how many tens of billions of gallons of jet fuel are produced globally from a petroleum-based, you know, traditional production techniques? From sustainable aviation fuel, I mean, how much fuel is the scale is very small. As we get into the billions of gallons, that gap closes more and more, and you don't need the same level of carbon offsets in order to get you in line with parity. But you got to start somewhere. And so this kind of low carbon fuel standard that we have in the U.S. is allowing us to expand our production and grow. And I mean, look, there are other countries as well. And I mean, in the last year, there are countries that are starting to mandate sustainable aviation fuel to the commercial, airline industry. And I think that's going to kind of happen more and more. And that'll just drive it. That'll drive the industry, and over time, it'll bring the cost down as well.
Chris, thanks so much.
That was long-winded. Yeah,
no, sorry. I know this is good. I have a feeling we're going to completely blow past the time that we had allocated for this, but it's really good content and really good input. But thanks for joining, and I know it's late there in Denver, so we should let you get back to your non-carbohydrate fuel-based meals, your corn on the cob that's allocated for food, not for fuel, there in Denver. But we really appreciate your feedback and your input and sharing a bit about the Gevo story. And I if you're open to it, I'm sure we might have some people that might have some follow-up questions afterwards.
Yeah, look, I'm happy to. I'll probably drop off here shortly, but shoot me an email and I'm happy to, to talk to anyone. We can exchange emails or I'm happy to have a call with anyone and just talk about it.
Appreciate it. Thank you, Chris.
Thanks, guys.
Cool.
Thanks, Chris.
Excellent. We'll revert back to Australia now, I think. Jeff, are you still there?
I am still here. I just got off there.
Okay, perfect, Jeff. Excellent. So Jeff's going to talk a little bit about, I guess, other pathways in terms of bio-based chemicals as well. Jeff sits on you've got it right there, right, on the IEA Task 42 for biorefining. So you're going to give a little bit of a global perspective in terms of bio-based chemicals as well, right, Jeff?
Correct. So this will be somewhat broader than... so it won't be too specific. Is my screen up?
Go for it. It's over to you. Yeah, you're presenting, so go for it. It's
sharing. Let me just check. Is it on full screen now?
Not yet. We can see it, but not full screen yet.
Not full screen? Because it should
be. No, not full screen yet.
Hmm.
Dual monitors.
Yeah, three monitors, got a whole bunch.
we can still see it pretty clearly if you want to just write.
Okay, look, why don't we, we might muck around too long otherwise. So look, thanks, David, for the introduction. I don't want to talk too much about us, but I really wanted to talk about biochemicals. That's a big area to talk about. I want to give a little bit of a background about me and the company first. I don't want to make it the focus of the talk, but just a little bit about us. I'm the CEO of a company called Microbiogen. most of you probably will have never heard of us. We are actually a leading global industrial biotechnology company, only about 20 employees, but we've been around for a long time, about 20 years. And in that time, we sort of have specialized in a particular bug called Saccharomyces cerevisiae. It underpins about $1 trillion worth of products per year. So it's the microorganism used in the world. And that's what we do. And in fact, we've been relatively successful. We've now developed the world's best biocatalyst for biofuel production. So a large part of the world's biofuels now produced using our biocatalyst. We're also working with the Australian government. We're currently completing an $8 million ARENA grant, and that's for optimization of biocatalysts for second generation biofuels. So that's the waste rather than the food to fuels. That's going really, really well. And you know, we expect a good 15 to 20% reduction in operating costs in that area. So good applications there going forward. So I guess one of the things to say is you may not hear necessarily a lot going on in biotech or biofuels, but a lot is being done in the background and progress is being made. The final thing I wanted to say is I'm also head of the Australian IEA Task 42, and what we do in that task is we look at biorefining, not just biofuels, but a whole range of products, chemicals, fuels, feed that go into a circular economy. So that's enough about me. Moving forward to what I want to talk about, I want to talk about the dominant platforms that are out there today.
Hey, Jeff, sorry, just one thing. Your slides are not progressing, though.
They're not?
No.
Oh, hang on. Wait a minute. That should be.
There we go. Now they are. Yep.
That's strange. Okay. So I want to talk about those dominant platforms today that are out there. Because there are so many platforms, I will focus in on ethanol, and I want to talk a little bit about why ethanol is such a great product, a little bit about supply and future trends, and then look at ethanol as like a new crude oil with multiple applications, particularly biochemicals, et cetera. So moving forward, this is a little bit of a complicated chart, but I'm just trying to set the scene. So if we start with sustainable biomass supply, you put that into some sort of pre-treatment technology, and what you'll come out with is a number of what's called intermediate products: proteins, sugars, lignin, oils, fat, and fibers. And all those can be converted to a number of materials. So not just bioenergy, but out of that biomass goes food, feed, biochemicals, and materials. Now, to actually get to these materials, there's a number of platforms you can use, and that's on the left-hand side here. You can use things like syngas. You can go the biogas route. You can use C5, C6 sugars, plant oils, algae. There's a whole range of these platforms that you can use to get to the food and the feed and the chemicals. The two leading platforms today are the C5 and C6 sugar platforms and the plant-based oils. So those are the platforms that would be producing most of the world's liquid fuels or bioenergy today. So if we move forward and continue, so I want to focus in on ethanol and try and explain why ethanol has taken off and why so much is produced today. So if you start off with biomass, whether it's sugarcane, corn, biomass, forest, whatever, roughly 70 to 75% of any of that material is sugar. The other 20 to 25%, depending on the biomass, it's either lignin or protein. So if it's corn, it'll be mostly protein and other materials which can get put into food. If it's sugarcane, bagasse, or biomass, it's 20 to 25% lignin. Regardless of that, that 70 to 75% sugar is what you can use biochemically. There's a range of sugars there. But I want to give you an example and explain why people do produce so much ethanol. So if you take 1 ton of sugar, and it can be a whole range of these sugars, glucose, sucrose, mannose, et cetera. And if that 1 ton of sugar has 1,000 energy units, that's energy of combustion, you can put that into a yeast fermentation, that 1 ton of sugars. And what you'll end up with is essentially three products. The yeast will grow a bit. You'll get about 40 kilograms of that, which is 50% protein and high value feed. You'll get about 0.5 0.46 tons of carbon dioxide, which actually has zero energy units in it. What you also get is about 0.46 tons of ethanol, but it contains roughly 900 energy units. So what you've done is the yeast take that sugar, rearrange the molecule, take a little bit of energy out of it, and convert it to a higher energy product. And that's one of the reasons why ethanol is so widely used today. It's a very, very efficient process and has been around for a long time. So I'll just move on. How much of this material can be produced? Well, the world produces over 100 billion tons of biomass per year. So that's absolutely no shortage of sugar. You've got 75 billion tons available effectively. And remember, the sugars aren't the proteins and the fats and the nutrients. These are, as they say, are carbohydrates with not a huge amount of nutritional value. So they are ripe for change into other products. Another advantage of ethanol is once you've done your distillation, it's almost a pure product. So it's not like, you know, gasoline or whatever, which is full of a whole range of different molecules. When you produce ethanol, it's essentially a pure product. It's clean and safe. It's not difficult to do. It's a well-understood technology. When you produce all that carbon dioxide, it can be captured. Now, it can be used. You can put it underground if you wanted to and make a negative emission plant. But you can also use that carbon dioxide for example, for things like carbonation for soft drinks. If you add energy, you can even turn that carbon dioxide into fuels as well. So there's some of the reasons why it's not just extraordinary conversion, but other things that make ethanol something that is an advantageous product. And if you look, if you go back over the last 40 years, you can see what's happened to fuel, to ethanol production. You know, back in 1975, there was virtually none. If you go to, by the year 2000, it was about 20 million tons produced per year, but you can see the growth in the last couple of decades, and most of that growth has been in fuel ethanol. There are non-fuel applications. Obviously, we drink it, and then there's things like hand sanitizers, potable, etc. So if you look at this chart, you know, back in 2000, you know, I guess what, it's gone up four or five fold in the last decade, couple of decades. Australian production has basically stayed flat to actually potentially declining. So it really hasn't done much at all. So Australia is really not keeping up with what's going on in the rest of the world. And I'd also point out that this fuel ethanol production has gone up despite the best endeavours of the incumbents to not let it go up. There are roadblocks everywhere in terms of getting fuels into the market. Fuel ethanol is a great octane enhancer, oxygenate. It's actually required in fuels. But this could be a much, much higher number if there wasn't so much resistance from the incumbents. Where are we going to go into the future? Mandates are really, really important. Without government mandates, a lot of this wouldn't happen. It's not that it's not a good fuel. It's that the incumbents will resist. And you can see this is actually a diagram from our friends at Novozymes, and you're talking about very significant lifts in ethanol production going forward. They're really driven by the large economies, the US, China, Brazil, and India. They're all mandating increases. We are missing out on those opportunities in Australia, and Australia has a natural advantage, so it should be included in this list of companies increasing. And as talked about before, I won't go into it, but we do as a country remain exposed to supply disruptions of fuels and chemicals. So I just put this one little chart in just for everyone to think about hand sanitizers. It was an interesting thing that happened when COVID came in, and you know, people were scrambling to try and find ethanol because you need ethanol for hand sanitizer. So if we take an example, you know, suppose every time a person sanitized their hand, they used just 1 mL of ethanol, and each person in the world sanitized their hand 10 times a day, which is a very high assumption, and everyone did it, which would never happen, then you'd use 27 billion litres of ethanol per year. Remember, we already produce 120 billion litres. So there's no shortage of hand sanitizer, but it does show that if you have one product that is used for fuel, it can quickly be used for other things if it's if required. A little bit more background of ethanol as a new crude. You can see today, if I'm going to look at ethanol versus biodiesel production, they are all increasing in volumes. Ethanol continues to increase, biodiesel continues to increase, and the new technology biodiesel is increasing as well. And in terms of, if we want to talk about biochemicals, roughly 70% of biofuels today are bioethanol. And over 330 million tons of chemicals are produced per year from fossil fuels. Now, if you consider ethanol as a chemical, as a biochemical, then roughly 90 million tons of bio-based chemicals are produced per year, and roughly 90% of that is ethanol. So ethanol's there, it's already a biochemical, it can be converted to biochemicals. And there's no shortage of sugars in this world to produce it. So I think that there's a good argument to say that ethanol is something that's going to grow, it's going to continue to grow, and it's an opportunity that Australia should be looking at very closely because it has immediate mandate opportunities for fuels, but there are other applications as well. And I'll just want to move that towards my final chart, is why could ethanol be considered a new crude oil? Well, if you take a look, if you just have a plant that's producing ethanol from sugars with the byproduct of feed, if you use a second generation facility, so that's a facility that uses sugarcane bagasse or waste from crops or forest thinnings, if you put that through a second generation ethanol facility and add the ethanol to the lignin, you've got a low sulfur marine fuel. And that's one of the things that the world needs. If you take that ethanol, you can dehydrate it to ethylene. And then you can convert, once you've got ethylene, you can convert ethylene to plastics and other materials for packaging, detergents, polystyrene, very wide applications. You can also take the ethanol and use catalytic conversion to butadiene. And then you can get striene butadiene, nitrile butadiene, et cetera. And these are all precursors for tires, toys, et cetera. So pretty much anything you can do with fossil fuels, you can pretty much do with ethanol. And remember, ethanol is a nice pure product. It actually makes the process easier. There are processes where you can take ethanol, put it through an alcohol to jet, and you can come up with jet fuel. You can use it as an oxygenate for current cars, an octane enhancer, or as in Brazil, it's your primary fuel for cars and light trucks. And then finally, there are companies, Scania, for example, have developed engines that can use high octane ethanol for effectively a diesel style truck. So there are a huge number of applications for ethanol. As I said, ethanol, easy to produce, well understood, highly efficient at conversions. So we tend to look at it as the new crude oil. So I think that's a great opportunity for Queensland and Australia. Australia has a natural advantage in biomass. We have technology. We're a stable country. We do have too much reliance on imports of product. There's not enough diversity of manufacturing critical inputs, and so it would help diversify that. As I said, we have that natural advantage. We diversify away from that high level of critical fuel imports, and it can be produced at volume. It's not like this is a whole new risky technology required here. This is well understood technology that continues to develop and get better today. And if there is another pandemic, we have those other things we can do. And as I said, the final point would say it really does advance that regional development and boost resilience. So look, that's it from me. I'd be very happy to answer any questions.
Beautiful. Yeah, thanks, Jeff. That's really, really helpful, I think, providing that context, and I think even providing the insight into the various different pathways, the various different platforms. I think that's really helpful for those of us that are not from the sector itself to kind of understand those opportunities. Any questions from anyone in attendance? I noticed there was one comment in the chat, but I think that's actually more referring to some comments that Shahana made around bioenergy projects. I'm not sure if that's something that you can answer, Jeff, but probably might be relevant for Shahana.
I think I'd leave that for Shahana.
Yeah, perfect. No worries. I mean, this is probably akin to the question that Derek asked earlier, Jeff. What action should we be taking here in Queensland? Right? Like, there's a tremendous opportunity there. Sounds like ethanol is an incredible platform or starting point to take down different approaches to different, you know, a whole range and a whole suite of different products. What's missing, do you think? So we have some ethanol mandates in Queensland. What more should we be doing?
I think you guys have started to make the right steps. You have put those mandates in, and those mandates are increasing. I think we're starting to head in the right direction. You know, you've got the roadmap being talked about. So I think that, in a strange way, COVID has demonstrated some of the opportunities out there that otherwise aren't being ignored, but they're not being acted upon. You know, it does take money. But I think that what you really need is, if you look to the rest of the world, you know, if you look at the US and Brazil, all they did was put in the mandates. So once the mandates are there, the rest follow. But, you know, no one's going to build a plant unless there's somewhere for it to go.
Mm-hmm.
And unless you actually force the fuel companies to put it in, I can tell you, it's not going to go in. I mean, in New South Wales, I think a mandate 6%, but we're putting in at less than 2% because it's not being enforced. So these mandates not just have to have a mandate, but it has to be an enforced mandate, or it simply won't happen. Once you've got that infrastructure in and people have built and are producing these things, then that's great. And look, you know, I'm just using ethanol as an example. You know, there are other you can produce your butanols and all the rest of it. There will be other products that have their niche products or maybe more suitable for other processes. But one of the things I think, when you look to develop a new industry, if you go that step extra where you're taking on a lot of technology risk, that's going to be the difficult step. What's nice about ethanol is it's not a technically risky thing to do, and we have everything in place to do it. It just needs the market to put it in.
Yeah. Derek, you got a question?
Well, it may not be relevant, but I guess the whole food to fuel argument that started way back when with ethanol production in the U.S. is that argument's been won by you guys and lost by the opponents, right? We're not compromising or sacrificing, you know, food supply to produce ethanol. I mean, it was sort of a silly argument I heard, I don't know, many years ago, but I'm assuming that argument's done deal, right?
I think that that's still out there. I mean, all the evidence suggests that it's not a problem. I mean, look, if you take corn, for example, you know, there is a limit to how much corn you're going to be producing. But I look at a corn plant, particularly an ethanol plant, as a biorefinery. I look at it as an upgrading plant for corn, because when, you know, corn is 75% sugar, it's not actually very good for the animal. So taking out the sugars is not really a problem. You're retaining your protein. In fact, through the process, you're growing yeast and actually enhancing some of the nutrients in the process. But food versus fuel should never be discounted. I think it was just overblown and used as a reason not to do anything.
Yeah.
I think, like all things, you need to have some sort of management over what's going on. I mean, the interesting thing is, when we move to second generation biofuels, I mean, even our technology converts waste that is no food into fuel and feed. So you'll actually get more food when you go to second generation than you will, you know. We worked out that if you grew, you know, sugar cane and converted that to fuels and feed instead of grazing cattle, you actually make more food than you would otherwise do. So I think that those things all disappear. But I think you'll find a large part of the population still think a few things. Ethanol's bad for your car. Producing biofuels uses up all our food, and that we're all going to starve. So I think that message is out there. The competitors did a fantastic job to demonize biofuels, mm-hmm. and I think you'll find that's there for a long time yet.
Yeah, perfect. And just, sorry, Jeff, one real quick follow-on question from Wade Clark. Are there any general international rules around what can be used for human consumption versus fuels? I guess, are there, are there, is there legislation limiting that, that's restricting that?
Well, I always find this interesting because, you know, I can tell you, because we're in the spaces, the same bug is used to produce your the beers and wines that you drink. And they also, when you produce wine or beer, the same yeast is used. In other words, that yeast will be producing the ethanol, but it will also be producing small amounts of butanol, fusel oils, etc. So because it's natural, I guess the government doesn't worry about what those things are doing for you. I'm suggesting that sometimes if you drink a bit too much of the wrong wine, you get a bit of a headache, and that's not necessarily the alcohol, it might be a bit of the fusel oils, etc. But no, look, I'm not aware of the regulations. Certainly once you go to a large full-scale plant, you need to look at getting certified for a range of different products. So for example, I don't think you could put fuel alcohol produced ethanol straight into a distillery. You would need to go through a certification process.
Can I, David, quickly respond to that one as well? Just,
yes.
And I suppose this is sort of stemming from the whole discussion around food versus fuel, but the major off-takers and the governments that are setting mandates in this space are requiring incredibly rigid life cycle analysis in terms of the production of ethanol. Particularly if we're looking at the aviation space and the rigor that they're placing around the biofuels that would be appropriate for them to be purchasing. So there are some really strong certification processes globally, and really in terms of, biofuels need to be in order for them to be qualifying for things such as the EU mandate or the LCFS or aviation and the like, all of those components are actually taken into account so that any challenges around land use change, water, all sorts of things are actually included as part of that process. So I suppose just to give some comfort that whilst there are these murmuring sort of, views that pop up here and there, the reality is for fuels today to actually be able to make their way to market and to be certified to, for these off-takers to purchase it, that they're having to meet incredibly high standards. And in Australia, it is, all of the ethanol that's being produced in Australia is coming as a byproduct from another stream. So the argument in Australia for food versus fuel is completely redundant.
Mm. Perfect. Yeah, that's good. Good feedback, Shana. Jeff, thanks so much. Really appreciate your presentation. I think it was really valuable for a lot of people, so definitely for myself. So thanks, Jeff.
Thank you.
Excellent. We might throw over to Greg. Greg, are you still there? Sorry, I know we're, again, way behind time on this session. There we go.
Yep.
I'm seeing your presentation.
Okay. Can you hear me?
We can. Yes. Go for
great.
Do you want to try? Do you want to try going to presentation mode? Excellent. So Greg's going to talk through a bit of what Sydney Water is doing in biogas.
Thanks, David. Yeah, just a bit of background on Sydney Water, first of all. We're Australia's largest water and wastewater provider. We serve over 5 million people across Sydney, Greater Sydney. So we treat water, we treat wastewater. I'm going to focus on the wastewater side of things. We have around 28 wastewater treatment plants, and they're quite geographically dispersed. That's what I'm going to focus on. So just a quick lesson, first of all, on cogeneration. When water comes into a treatment plant, we remove the solids. We put those solids into a digester. If it's an anaerobic digester, then we can generate methane around 60% and carbon dioxide around 40%. That is called biogas, and we use that to generate electricity in a reciprocating engine. We also collect the heat from that engine, and there's other applications I'm going to talk about right now. So we self-generate about 20% of the electricity that we use. So that converts to about 80 gigawatt hours per year of hydro, which is about 20% of that. and the rest is biogas cogeneration, which I just spoke about. So I mentioned anaerobic digestion. We have around 14 different anaerobic digesters across Sydney. The rest are aerobic. The anaerobic digesters, you can see on the map there, are the red dots. And you can see they're quite dispersed across Sydney, which I'll go into its benefits later. So the benefit of cogeneration is it generates electricity. The best use of that electricity is behind the meter. So if we're exporting the electricity, we don't get the financial benefit that we do if we just use that electricity on the site that we're generating at. So we have an energy master plan, and in that plan we're planning to double biogas production by 2030. So that means we need a lot more anaerobic digesters and make better use of the digesters that we've got. So we've got a couple of new plants coming online that we know of before 2030. So we've got a bit of work to do to get there. And the important point here is the wastewater contains about 5 times as much chemical potential energy than is required to run our entire wastewater. So we extract biogas. We can potentially extract a lot more energy from that wastewater. So here's just a graph that shows the energy that we do collect and how that compares to what we use in terms of electricity on site. So Bondi stands out there. We generate enough electricity to run the site entirely on biogas. Having said that, that's net. So we need to import electricity at times, and at other times we produce more electricity than we need on site, so we export it. We have secondary and tertiary plants, which means we need to inject air into the plants to provide food for the bugs to treat the sewage better than at the other three plants. So those are Cronulla, Glenfield, Wollongong, Liverpool and Warriewood. What that shows is we can generate between 40 and 60% of our electricity for those secondary and tertiary plants. But Wollongong is the exception there. It's around 27%. And the reason for that is at some of our plants, we produce recycled water and that consumes a lot of power. So which is the reason Wollongong is so low there. So back to this diagram, it showed us how we produce biogas using wastewater solids, but the little bit in the bottom left there shows that we can also add other organics to the digesters, and that will help us produce more biogas. So things like some liquids like beer waste or solids like pulped waste, pulp food waste, if we inject those into a digester, we produce more biogas. And that's called food waste co-digestion. We're currently trialing at Cronulla. We've also done it at Bondi. The reason we're trialing it at Cronulla, and it's still a trial, is we're still working out the technical issues, and we think we've sorted those out, and also the commercial issues. So we're just trying to work out what are the commercial benefits. And those commercial benefits are in terms of gate fees. So we charge trucks based on a tonnage of food waste that they're providing us, and we inject that into the digester, and as a result we get more biogas, which means we can generate more electricity. So those are the two main benefits. We're also looking at the science of co-digestion. We have a research facility at Shell Harbour, and we're looking at the impact of various food waste types on a mini digester. And there's great variation between, you know, some of the beer, wine waste compared to pulp food waste, and also FOG, which stands for fats, oil and grease, which is a waste on many many treatment plants, which has an amazing potential, but it's very difficult to deal with because it's solid. a lot of the time at ambient temperature. So from that research facility, we've developed a model to help us work out what the outcomes will be in terms of biogas production, in terms of the additional solids that we have to take away, and the solids that we extract from digesters are called biosolids. We have to truck those, you know, up to 600 or 800 kilometres away over the mountains, and we add that to farmland, which is great for the farms, but it's costly for us because we have to truck it quite a distance. When we're adding food waste, we have to be careful that we don't add to that solid waste, and therefore to the cost. So I mentioned that our anaerobic digesters are quite dispersed, and that has a benefit in that there's a lot of local industry that are trying to get rid of their waste products, and they would normally be getting rid of that to landfill. So if we can divert from landfill, we can also create renewable energy, what we're doing is we're providing a local solution to some city waste management issues. And we're currently developing a strategic plan to help us provide those benefits while also providing us with the financial benefits. So I mentioned cogeneration as one solution to giving us a financial benefit from the biogas. Another solution is biomethane. So that's it's basically treating biogas, removing all the carbon dioxide and the other impurities, and producing biomethane, which we can then inject into the natural gas grid. There's some commercial examples overseas, but we are looking to be the first in Australia. We've got a proposal to produce biomethane at Malabar, and we're currently partnering with Gemina and just about over the line with ARENA in getting funding support. But the question is, how do the economics of biogas compare to biomethane now? So what we've found is it's on par, at least. And certainly in the future, with rising natural gas prices, we think that'll produce quite a benefit for us. And the other benefit is diversifying. So just say electricity prices really drop, that makes cogen financially unviable, but we still have biomethane that we can fall back on. So when we look at anaerobic digesters and wastewater treatment plants as a whole, we see them as a bioresource hub, certainly with our team, and we're slowly convincing Sydney Water. So for example, from wastewater treatment plants, you can produce recycled water. From anaerobic digesters, you get the organics, I already mentioned, the biosolids, which you can apply to land. But you can also extract specific nutrients such as nitrogen and phosphorus, which can be applied locally. We're also looking at industrial enzymes and bioplastics. And the other one that we, as you know, we're currently doing is biogas. So a specific example of this that we're working with various government organisations to get underway is creating a circular economy out in Western Sydney. At the moment, they're building a new airport out in Western Sydney. There's going to be a lot of growth out there. There currently is a lot of growth, but there will be a lot more. There's going to be an agribusiness precinct with glasshouse. Industrial size glass houses, and we see ourselves playing a part in that. So for example, we receive their green waste, we put that green waste into a digester, we produce biogas, which we can burn and produce heat for the glasshouses. And I mentioned carbon dioxide is a byproduct of biogas, is a component of biogas, which the glasshouses can also use. With the wastewater, we can provide them with the recycled water. So that's my presentation. Happy to take questions.
Brilliant. Thanks, Greg. Yeah, appreciate it. It's always good to see actual, firsthand case studies domestically, particularly from a major utility like Sydney Water. Does anyone have any questions for Greg? Paul, I think.
Yeah, Greg, do you see the increase of feedstocks happening, or do you see a decline just because the commodity is a well-wanted resource?
Yeah, it's a good question. At the moment, there's not too many competitors. I don't see it in decline at all in the near future, simply because sending it to landfill has a cost, and the gate fee that we would be charging would be significantly less than that cost to landfill. I do see competitors coming in the future, just because biogas, biomethane has a value, and there is already one competitor in Sydney. We don't see ourselves as competitors at the moment, but in the future, who knows? In the future, I do see competitors in the near future. No, though.
Very good. Excellent. Any other questions for Greg? Greg, thanks so much for taking your time. Sorry we're running a little bit late, but really good to hear what you're up to south of the border, Ross.
Not a problem. Thanks for the opportunity. Excellent.
Yeah, very good. Perfect. And then over to our final presenter. Again, I'm trying to find my slides, but I'm just gonna hand over to you, Stuart, because by the time I pull them up, you probably have yours. So there he is.
Hopefully, what can you see there? Is it?
I can see your first slide. You're making.
Okay. It. Yeah. Right. Yeah. Well, let's get into it then.
Yeah. Perfect. So go for it, Stuart.
There's a bit of a disclaimer there, and just so quickly, Licella Holdings. It's an Australian company, privately owned. It's been beavering away since the early 2000s with a technology that is called the high temperature, catalytic reaction process, which takes supercritical water, and it'll treat a number of streams, plastics and biomass and brown coal, etc., and turn that into basically a bio crude or a crude oil. The technology has been successful around the world. It's we have Canfor in Canada, which is a major pulp and paper company looking to roll it out into pulp and paper mills. Armstrong Energy in the UK looking to roll out with plastics, 20,000 ton plastics plant there. I'm here today as a project manager for a study we're undertaking up in the Burdekin, which we'll come to shortly. So just quickly, the technology. Can you see my cursor there when I'm spinning around?
Yep, sure can. Yep.
Okay, so typical inputs. It's fairly varied. And really what it does, converts it through these catalytic high temperature reactors. The crude oil is distilled into a number of fractions. And that crude either is bitumen or biocrude can go through further processing into diesel, or marine crudes, or heavy fuel oil, which is widely used in boilers and ships and so on. Or it can go back into producing other chemicals. So it kind of closes the loop without the sort of emissions that you get from, say, burning municipal solid waste or having to landfill it. It's really quite a good outcome for end-of-life plastics in particular. So again, you can't have a presentation without a bit of a complex slide. So this is one of the few that we've got, hopefully. So if we look at biocrude, which is really from biomass, and plasticrude from end-of-life plastics, the outcome is slightly different. You know, with a bio crude from biomass, it's about 60% of the fuel is 60% is produced as fuel oil and 40% as bitumen. So it produces a heavy crude, and then the bitumen is a very, very heavy crude. And that typically, you know, bitumen goes into a number of applications, which councils in particular are very familiar with, given that they buy half the bitumen in Australia, all of which is a lot of which is imported. Plastic crude is a little bit different. It produces a range of lighter oil products, which allows it to go into a range of markets. So having a lot more carbon and less oxygen is beneficial in terms of its performance, and the residues go into bitumen. So just quickly with the biomass example that we're looking at in Australia and in the Burdekin, I'm sure everyone's familiar with that area up there, just south of Townsville. It's a twin cities of Eyre and Home Hill. But it's one of the premium sugarcane growing areas in the world with about 8 million tonne. But they burn cane every year. You know, there's something like 90 fires a day, which we'll show on the next slide. But what we're going to use in this study is a waste stream. It's not the bagasse, which comes from producing sugar. You know, they cut up the stalk and it goes to the sugar mill and they squeeze the juice out and you're left with bagasse. We're actually going to use the tops, which is a green sort of waste, and the dried leaves which fall to the bottom. And that's around 20% of the stalk. So in the Burdekin, it's about 1.6 million tonne a year. And that's why they have so many fires, because they've got to get rid of that before they harvest. So what we're proposing is to separate that at the end of the field, and the cane grower, the farmer, he sends off his cane to the sugar mill, gets a few bucks, although they're not making any money at the moment because the sugar price is down. And then they send the tops and trash to the refinery and make a few dollars. So we're looking at a commercial demonstration facility of 125,000 barrels per year. Typically, you know, they burn every day, and the growers really don't like it. You know, they have to go and burn late in the afternoon. They much prefer to sit back and have a beer. And it spews this thing called the Burdekin snow everywhere. So all this char ash comes down. What we propose is the full cane harvest. So we take everything off, we separate, and the billets go into to the sugar mill as usual. Nothing's changed. And then the tops and trash goes to the refinery. It's a great thing for regional communities, you know, something like 90 jobs created. And it's a very, the benefits spread quite widely across the community, from the growers to the harvesting contractors to the truck drivers to service providers. So it's a good, good spend. And the same with plastic crude in rural communities as well. So coming to the plastics example, you know, we're pretty good at throwing away plastic. There's not much else you can do with it. Most of, unfortunately, which ends up in landfill, particularly with the change that Shahana mentioned earlier with China and Project Sword, which reduces our ability to export. You know, plastic is very good. It hangs around forever, and there's still a lot out there. So we have in Australia some targets, which is about recycling and reusing, and that certainly requires that there's separation stations set up. And, you know, we all sort of know there's little numbers on each piece of plastic telling you what type of plastic it is. But there's a lot of technology needed to actually separate those things. Licella actually has a recycling joint venture in Somersby, where their pilot plant is, just in north central coast of New South Wales, about an hour north of Sydney. And that facility is, they produce take about 100,000 tonnes of waste comes in, and they separate it into the different plastic types and recycle. And then you've still got some at the end of life, which you just cannot recycle, which is ideal for conversion to plastic crude. So to get to this sort of level of recycling and reuse is going to require huge investment. Some of the plastic is recyclable, But a lot of it, just as we know today, because there's no market, ends up in incineration or landfill. Originally shipped to China, that's no longer the case. What we haven't got here is PVC, which is a bit of a problem for most recycling processes, but the Licella technology can take all of these plastics and it doesn't really need to be separated, although we do separation to make sure that there is high value recycling opportunities exploited. But you know, in the end, you've got quite a lot of plastics today that are multi-film, that have an outer layer which might be polystyrene in layer something else, and very hard to separate those and to create recyclable value. So if we look at the opportunity for what we call refineries, plastic crude refineries, you know, and this is based on an input of around 20,000 tons of plastics in Queensland. You know, there's something like four of those, mostly in the larger urban centres, and two in the smaller centres. So, you know, we know when you look at that, six plastic crude refineries is quite an opportunity for parts of Queensland. Overall, something like 28 facilities across Australia. So there is an enormous investment opportunity in Australia itself. So what we get, just coming back to our little synthetic barrel, we get the top and the bottom of the barrel is part of that, what we call that circular economy. You know, these light fractions go back into making plastics. That's typically naphtha in particular is a major source of plastics production, ethylene and other things, which goes into the formation of plastics. And at the other end, you know, these waxes and bitumens, they go into roads, so they're locked up. You know, that's a good use for those, a beneficial use, but it's locked up, so it's like a way of sequestering carbon dioxide in a sense, or carbon. The middle fraction, we know today, and Shahan has mentioned about the industries that are very much focused on reducing emissions. You know, 50% reduction in emissions for the marine industry and the aircraft industry. So low sulfur marine fuels is a great opportunity. And we know, you know, ports of Townsville, Gladstone Port, Bundaberg, all these ports have demand for shipping. Fuels, and for Australia, we are importing 100% of our marine fuels because we don't have that low sulfur heavy fuel oil that they require. Just so one of the benefits of recycling end of life plastics is that compared to, you know, waste to energy type systems, so incineration systems in particular, which are even worse, of course, because they don't generate any energy, is that you get this significantly higher value and significant reduction in CO2, which is you know, obviously what we all need to do. So something like 1.5 tons or 1.4 tons for every ton of end-of-life plastics. And these end up adding up to significant savings. So when you look across Australia, you know, we're heading up towards about 1 million tonnes of CO2 reduction from just simply recycling plastics into a plastic crude. So just a quick summary, you know, there's significant opportunity for Australia to show leadership. It has a world-beating technology in Licella's catalytic high temperature reaction process, and it's been rolled out, and I can give you some examples of that, which I'll just quickly. So Neste, you know, is a major producer of green fuels around the world. They'd be the world's largest producer. Nestle, you know, looking to produce plastics from recycled fuels. Their target is to reduce virgin plastics by a third. You've got Mars, again, you know, 100% of their plastic packaging to be reusable, recyclable, compostable. Unilever, these are all made, PepsiCo, P&G, Procter & Gamble, all huge companies with very strong recycling, reuse, green sourcing mandates within their organisations that are driving demand for low carbon plastics. You know, Shell. So again, very, very strong and rapidly growing position, which will demand that we continue to evolve and develop our use of plastics in a positive way. In regard to bitumen, you know, we import bitumen, so it is for Australia quite an expensive product. And local councils, we know, are a major buyer of bitumen. So, you know, nice to have a plastic crude refinery or biomass refinery there that's producing bitumen used locally. Make it hard for the people to complain about the roads if you're using your own bitumen that's made there. there are a number of advantages with the CAT HDR, the low-solid technology, particularly with plastics. It can handle that multi-layer packaging, which is becoming more and more common as we replace cans and milk bottles and other things. You know, there's a tendency to have multi-layer plastic, which is very, very difficult to recycle and reuse. The other benefit, I guess, is the scale. You know, like if you go to an incinerator, yes, it's very low scale. You can operate at a very low tonnage, but it has a very high emissions. And really, people don't like incinerators. They don't like waste to energy because it's emitting. It's got a big stack, and it's, you know, what's coming out of that stack? Is it got dioxins and all that sort of question? The low-solid technology is a very closed system. So it's a water, you know, the fluid that's creates this very high temperature reaction is supercritical water. So it breaks down, it acts as a solvent, breaks down all the plastics into lighter, lower molecular weight chains. And it's not emitting gaseous, emissions. So you've got a very clean technology, which is suitable at a relatively low input. You know, 10,000 tonnes, 20,000 tonnes is not a huge volume of waste required to make these things work. Very scalable. So it's quite attractive for certainly for large urban centres, but certainly smaller regional centres as well. So look, I've got other slides, but I just sort of thought it's worth sort of giving some time to questions from people. You know, I've talked a little bit about some of the benefits against pyrolysis and gasification, incineration, and generally in here, you know, you can see it's got that range of benefits, which is positive, very high yield as well relative to other technologies.
Stuart. Yeah, Stuart, you've definitely sparked a couple of questions. You've got a couple of people with their hands up and already comments in the chat. So should we throw to them, or do you have anything else?
Look, I think that sort of gives a snapshot of it, and certainly love to talk to questions.
Yeah, beautiful. Cool. Jeff, I think you've got your hand up.
Look, thanks, Stuart. Very interesting. I just had got two questions. One is COVID-19, has it helped you get towards deployment of your technology, or is it a hindrance? And the second question was, if you had to choose between a trash HTR or a waste plastic HTR plant, do you have a preference? Is one more economic than other, which is best suited to your technology, I guess?
Yeah, I think COVID-19 really hasn't had a lot of impact on us. I think, you know, as a technology, we're still moving forward with the Burdekin project, and we've slowed down a little bit. It's difficult to get samples and get trucks to take stuff to different locations. But other than those sort of simple things, we're sort of moving forward. I think around the world, because there are projects in the UK and elsewhere, there's been a continuing focus on, getting things done, and agreements with other companies. although, you know, my role in Licella is that more project manager on that Vertican one than focusing on the broader commercial side. In terms of the benefit of Cat HTR against other, you know, waste to energy technologies, I guess the issue for me with waste to energy and incineration is that you're burning stuff, or pyrolysis and others, that there is ultimately, you're burning stuff in air, and that leaves a lot of nitrogen, which you've got to get rid of, and that's carrying, what's it carrying to the external environment?
Yeah, whereas, the question was actually slightly different. Is if you had two projects, one based on waste plastic and one based on sugarcane trash, does one project stack up better than the other? Do you have a preference for, you know, economically, which one makes the most sense? I guess that was the...
Yeah, okay. So I think waste plastics generally are, would be easier to justify. So the throughput for a waste plastics facility may only be 20,000 tonnes. For a biomass facility, it might be 70,000, 90,000 tonnes, if that helps answer the question, you know. So you need a larger input-output for biomass compared to plastics. And the reason for that is that biomass has a lot of oxygen in it, so the yield is significantly less. You know, it's about half the yield with biomass compared to plastics. So automatically, you know, you're going to have to do a lot more work with a biomass-based facility.
Right, thanks.
In saying that, we are looking at using some of the agricultural waste, plastic waste, you know, the polyethylene surface mulch and the polypropylene trickle tape and stuff like that, of which there is a reasonable quantity in the Vertican. So, you know, we are looking to utilise some of that in with the biomass to try and facilitate and help the process work a little bit better.
Over to you, Paul. You got a question?
Yeah, I just wanted to ask Stuart if with his interactions with the project development, have you had many interactions with council, and what sort of things do you foresee as developing in that relationship with council? What sort of areas would you suggest councils focus on?
Yeah, well, certainly, the project in the Burdekin came as a result of discussions with the council. So Licella were invited to visit, or encouraged to visit, which they did, which was, you know, a very positive thing. Met with the council, who are very supportive. And, I think the good thing about the company is that they are amenable to getting out and talking and, you know, trying to understand how to get a project to work. In the case of the Burdekin, you know, there was both a group, so the growers and the council working together to facilitate that. But, if council has a resource or has parties that have a resource that would like to discuss, certainly any discussions, you know, Licella will be available to talk.
Stuart, there was a question from Wade, which I think you actually just answered in the question from Jeff regarding the scale of tonnage for a plastic crude refinery. So you mentioned it was 20,000 tonnes for plastic?
Yeah, look, I think a smaller facility might be in the order of 10,000 tonnes. So I think, you know, there's smaller and larger sort of facilities.
I have no idea what sort of scale that is. Is that, do you typically find that from one council? Do you typically find that from a number of councils actually coming together to help to build a business case?
Yeah, so there's 2.5 million tonnes of waste plastic. I guess if you look at that on a per person basis, what are we talking, 100 kilograms per person or something in Australia? Is that right? Someone might have better maths than me. So, you know, you need a certain population to be able to see enough plastic thrown out. But, you know, say Townsville, Burdekin, you know, Burdekin with Sundays, you know, where there's a lot, it depends. Some areas have a lot of plastic without realising it, you know, that some of those agricultural areas where they're, they're using trickle tape and growing vegetables. It can be a huge amount of plastic. Other regions, if there's a significant amount of construction waste, for example, you know, there might be a fair bit of plastics tied up in that.
Perfect.
Yeah, so a discussion worth having. You know, you've got to go and talk to the people and find out what's available and how we could make it work.
Yeah, okay, great. Okay. Derek, we might throw to you, and that's probably the last question because we've dragged this one out for a couple of hours, but it's been worthwhile. Derek.
Oh, yeah, I just had a question about, let me ask the question differently. So oftentimes we hear about the contestable nature of these opportunities where, you know, lots of different councils like, oh, I can get a, maybe we can get a plant here or a plant there. But then when you start drilling down to the economics, whether it's transport and logistics, the quantity of waste that you need and the type, you know, the offtake agreements or the proximity to the end user or the product that comes out, that really you start getting a better picture of where these plants could potentially be. And then if you have like 20 councils on this call, you find out maybe only four of them would be viable as potential locations. So I wonder if you might be able to get into some of those without, in the short amount of time you have, just kind of give us some idea of like, there's not going to be an opportunity for most councils to do this, maybe a few of them and where they might be or something like that, just to, you know, drill this down a little bit more.
Yeah, look, I think that's a valid comment. You know, when you've got waste, you have to have contractual structures in place to manage that waste. And that means that there'll be, in some cases, some Australian companies, some multinational companies that manage waste streams. You know, and those contracts can extend for certain, you know, for quite lengthy periods, which in a sense, what you've done is you've tied up your waste and a waste processing pathway, and that's what councils have to do. You know, there's just no choice in making sure that there is no failure, you know, in sustainably getting rid of waste. So there needs to be a discussion that occurs as those contracts, you know, well before those contracts come up for renewal, and a strategy that says, how am I going to, you know, do better next time or add value or deal with waste in a certain way. So, you know, we think councils have a particularly important role in encouraging those larger companies to look at different technologies. You know, Canberra, for example, recently banned incineration and waste to energy, but the company taking the waste, they want to build a waste to energy facility, you know. So you have these sort of conflicts going on, I guess, all the time in those contractual structures. But certainly having a strategy, a longer-term strategy in place would help us to be able to talk and plan and do things sensibly.
And that's exactly what we're doing at the Council of Mayors. That's my quick commercial plug.
It's good, Derek. Very fitting. It's good, Derek. Excellent. Stuart, thanks so much for running through that. It's really helpful. I think we'd love to, collectively, I think a lot of us would love to see how we can help support to see some of these projects and waste plastic refineries set up in parts of Queensland where it makes sense and the economic stand up. So thanks for the background. Really appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity.
Excellent. Perfect. Folks, we might wrap it there. You know, I figured 2 hours is probably long enough. You probably actually have other stuff you need to do during the day. But as you can see, it's been really, you know, there's some really good speakers. I think there's some really good and committed and passionate organizations and individuals that are willing to support. So, and I think many of them have been willing to support outside of this session as well. So if there's any follow-up that we, myself or Paul, could help facilitate on behalf of LGAQ with some of these speakers, we're certainly happy to do so. And I'm sure the speakers would be willing to help follow up if it means, you know, a chance of moving forward on some of these opportunities. So thanks for your time. And Paul, I think the plan is you're going to send a follow-up email with the presentations and the recording, link to the recording. Yeah,
that's correct.
Yep. Excellent. Thanks, everyone. We'll let you guys go. Hope everyone has a great day and great rest of the week. Thanks to all of our speakers too. Really, really appreciate it.
Thanks, David.
Okay. Thank you.
See you, everyone.
See ya.
Bye-bye.